It becomes even more subjective because then it has to stand the test of law. What the assessee states, he can supplement the more and more facts at various stages. At assessment level, he can give something, at CIT appeal level, he can give something, and IDAT, he can still supplement something. Plus, he has a junior consultant at the stage of assessment, slightly senior consultant at the stage of CIT appeal, and a senior counsel at the level of IDAT, and even better counsel at a higher level. So they can improve upon their case from time to time. But the department's case is restricted to the order. So whatever subjectivity is there, they have to always deal with it at all stages. So whatever we are doing now, whatever we are trying to achieve, is only to reduce the subjectivity within the overall thing. I don't think it can become a totally objective thing. Now, whether these provisions will really give relief, I don't know. It has, we have to go forward. But what we have already seen, when we started doing transfer pricing in 2003, we had large number of cases of software cases. Then when we started doing the transfer pricing cases, transfer pricing assessment in these cases, we found that there was not shifting of profits in, from India to outside India. Rather, very often there was shifting of profits from outside India into India. The main reason for the shifting of profit is that everything was exempt under NAR, NB or other provisions in India in respect of software. Whereas they were liable to pay tax at a high rate, maybe in US or India or in European countries. So there was really no incentive for these, more particularly the Indian multinationals, there was no incentive as such to shift profits outside India. Rather, the incentive was to shift it India. So we used to find many cases where they were exempted under 10 year PSB showing very high margin. They would say the comparable margin is 22% or 18%. The comparable margin is generally kept as low as possible. If I am also a tax practitioner, I will try to keep it as low as possible. So it would range between 8 to 12, 13% in a beyond that. And assessee's margin is generally shown as 35%, 40%, sometimes we would have even 80%. And if it is calculated as a ratio of cost, it would cross even 2 digits, it will be in 3 digits also, the profit markup on cost. So then in some of these cases, transfer pricing officers made a remark that the profit is excessive, maybe the tenant in the claim is also on the excessive side. So assessing officers in those cases where the transactions were subjected to TP under the TP provisions after 2002-03, the assessing officers tried to reduce the claim of deduction under section 10A or 10B, relying on the TP analysis. Now what the EOs did, probably they didn't do any hard work after that. They said, you yourself, the hapless assessee wanted to present a good picture before the department, transfer pricing officer. So he said, 14 is the margin of the comparables and my margin is 80%. Now this was spot by the assessing officer. They said, no, your arm's length margin is only 14%, you are disclosing 80%, so this is not arm's length margin, it is more than marginal profits. So they tried to deny the reduction rate under the NA or NB for the differential from 14 to 80% or whatever the SSC was showing. But even here we find there are at least 20-30 decisions of the tribunal that reported on this issue. That even with the TP provisions in place, which was clearly applicable in respect of those transactions, we have not been able to achieve any clarity or any clear-headedness on this issue. Various grounds have been taken, assessees have said merely because I have been more efficient, you cannot say this is more than normal profit, this is a profit attributable to my efficiency. Sometimes they said the transfer pricing officer has not changed my 10A claim, how can the assessing officer claim? I don't know how the transfer pricing officer is supposed to change the 10A claim. But this is an argument which has been made and accepted by the court. Sometimes they have said TP methods are profit-based methods as well as price-based methods. Price-based methods are not concerned with profit, whereas in 10A and 10B, we are concerned with more than normal profits. So a method based on price cannot be applied to determine this. Then the tribunal has come up in some cases to say an arm's length margin, arm's length profit or an arm's length price is not equivalent to normal profits or more than normal profits. So all these issues still remained even after the TP provisions were in place and they were applicable in respect of these cases. So now with the domestic transfer pricing provisions, probably there is a little bit more refinement in respect of these transactions, where they have said that arm's length price will be taken into account for determining the profits in respect of these specific transactions. So despite the TP provisions being in place, I don't foresee that all disputes will come to an end. Disputes will still be there because we as a society, we like to dispute everything. If you do something, the assessing officer will dispute. If the assessing officer does something, the taxpayer will dispute. So we like to dispute, that is good for all of us. That is not a problem. So I don't think the disputes are going to come to an end even after putting these domestic taxation provisions, domestic transfer provisions, pricing provisions in place. Still problems will be there. Another thing, I don't know, under section 40A, you say various expenses will be allowed based on these transfer pricing. provisions. If we look at the transfer pricing experience, more than 80% initially, now more than 90% of the cases we go for what is called a transactional net margin method. Now in this method, you can use it as a method to justify anything. You can use it as a method to justify even a loss. You can use it as a method to justify any profit margin. But any comparable, whatever you can readily lay your hands on. But whether this method can ever be used to determine the actual arm's length price for an expenditure which is being claimed, I have my doubts about that. Very often we do an entity level TNMM. Whenever it suits either party, if it suits the associate, they do an entity level TNMM. If it suits the department, they also do an entity level TNMM. And you say either the transactions are at arm's length or you want to make an adjustment. But whenever we have done that, we have now, it is very difficult to work back to a price of a specific transaction. And more so, if the value of transaction vis-à-vis the overall business activity of the associate is not very significant. That is, if the turnover is running into hundreds of crores and they are talking of a 10 crore or 20 crore transaction, then to determine an arm's length price of that transaction using the TNMM method is going to be very difficult. So, all this is okay for a foreign multinational company because they are equipped to deal with all this. They have done their global transfer pricing study beforehand. They have dealt with this problem in a number of tax jurisdictions for the last 20, 30 years. We have just new infants right now in this field. In Indian SOC, how much he or she will be equipped to deal with this kind of problem? We have to keep in mind that also because we are, after all, a very new entrant into this field. MNC companies have been dealing with this in various trans jurisdictions for the last many years, 20, 30 years. So, I have my doubts as to how the transfer pricing methods can be used for determining a claim under Section 48. As long as it is to accept a transaction at arm's length, everything is okay. But the moment you disturb a transaction, you say your transaction is not at arm's length, then applying any of the methods becomes extremely difficult. So these are issues which still we have to grapple with. Then, as far as what is the mechanism within the department to deal with domestic transfer pricing, I don't know. I am totally involved with my transfer pricing relating to international transactions. So far, there is nothing in place to say whether the transaction will be referred to the transfer pricing officer or whether the assessing officer will do it himself. Things are not yet in place. Of course, for you the returns are due, so your job has already started. For us, we have 1 year time to pick up the case on scrutiny and thereafter further estimate time to complete the assessment if it is referred to BPO. So backward counting has not started as yet. We still feel we have a lot of time. So our procedure is still not in place, but it will be in place in due course. But whether or not our position is in place, whether it is going to be referred to the directorate, TP directorate or not, the all-powerful assessing officer is already enabled. Whenever he wants, wherever he wants, once you file the return, the assessing officer is always having the power under the new provisions to apply the TP provisions the way he or she understands and make an adjustment if they are not satisfied. So I think this one-day seminar that we have organized for this domestic transfer pricing issue is really very timely, and I think the associate should be really helped to put their transactions in place. It was suggested before I started this brief say that maybe I should tell what the department expects from the SSE or what the department expects from the chartered accountants or the consultants. I must confess at the outset that whatever I know on transfer pricing, I have learned from you all. We did not have any training. If I have done something shortcut, that is because I have seen you doing the shortcut. If I have done something good, that is also because I have seen people have done something very nice in their transfer pricing audit. So I have copied that. So really for me to give you any feedback, because we look at the professionals, we see what they are doing and learn from them. Karishma here, I know her since she was a young girl, not married at that time. And I have learned from her, and like that there are many people who came before me, who argued cases before me. And I have learned from all of them. I have learned the value of, particularly from the before form of keeping to time. However late it may be, by 6 o'clock if I have given a date, they have always complied at the end of the day with their reply. It may be facts to me at 6 o'clock, but still they will try to comply. They may give reply on 3 questions out of the 10, but still they will give some reply by 6 o'clock. So I have also tried to imbibe all these qualities. So I may pick 3 cases, but still at least 1 case I will hear by the end of the day. and excuse myself for the remaining two. So really, I don't know what advice I can impart to you all, because we look up to the professionals to come up with something and we take the cue from there. But all the same, since I have been asked and we all are assembled here, what from my limited experience, what I have seen is that if the basic documentation of a transaction is properly maintained, and if the essence of the transaction can be put across properly to the transfer pricing officer, I mean half a mock battle is won. We have a tendency, both among the officers, I tell my officers also, not to jump to the conclusion. They want to jump to TNM method or some other method at the first instance itself. First itself they want to say, madam, we can reject these three loss-making companies and we can make an adjustment here. So that is the attitude of all of us, to jump to the conclusion. Similarly, even when assessees come before us and they argue, they want to go to the conclusion, they immediately say TNM method or some other method and my margin of comparability and things like that. But whatever I have felt from my limited experience, I feel that if you can really explain the core of a transaction with basic document, say the agreement with the other party, what transactions they have actually transferred, and if you could really build your documentation from that level, then whether or not you have made a profit or loss from the transaction, it is always much easier to explain such transactions. In the first year of transfer pricing, there were many cases where they were represented by the associates themselves. No big four firm came, nobody came to represent them. There were cases where there were hardly any comparable transactions available. But still, we were convinced in many of those cases that there was no transfer pricing adjustment required, even when there were losses, because they were able to explain to us what were the business considerations and other factors which resulted in the loss. And therefore, we have not made adjustments in many such cases. You may find that difficult to believe, but this is an academic forum, so I don't need to hide anything from anybody. So generally, we have been convinced. Another thing I find that whenever we have seen the associates themselves directly, beyond the consultants, and if the associates have explained their business properly, we find it more easy to get convinced, rather than hear everything from the consultant. So if you have an associate who can project this case properly, if he is smart also, there is no problem in taking him to the tax office. He knows what to say, what not to say. If he is not smart, but still you feel he has a genuine case, even then I think it will serve the purpose if you take the associate along with you to the tax office and make him put his facts before the tax office. We have generally been favorably impressed whenever the associates have come forward before us. I had a case of Zodiac, I think it was a case of Zodiac, where I was quite convinced that an adjustment was warranted in that case. In fact, initially I put up the file, we wrote an adjustment, and DI said, well, there is an adjustment, some commission has been paid to a Switzerland entity, Switzerland is a low tax jurisdiction. So this commission of 10 crore ought to be disallowed, please investigate more. So from the month of March till the month of February, I investigated that case. We asked for more and more information. Finally, the assessee brought not merely his managing director or somebody, he brought some of the foreigners who were doing marketing of this product in various parts of Europe. And they came before us and they gave documents and they produced their details to show that actually they are doing marketing for the Zodiac brand in various big outlets. They were making for putting the brand name of various other persons and manufacturing for them. And a lot of commission was paid for doing this marketing. So we were suspecting that commission is not at arm's length because it was paid to a Swiss entity. That prejudice is there. The moment you see Switzerland, the moment you see Singapore, the moment you see some other tax haven like British Virgin Islands, you feel something is wrong there. We start with the presumption. But when they brought all this, and I was convinced, we did not make any adjustment, and AI was convinced. So if your associate can project this case properly, then I would say that it pays to take the associate. Generally, there is a feeling that you should not take the associate at all to the tax office, keep him behind, and only consultant comes. Many times we are doing various foreign banks, they are insisting that the associate come, but the associates are never allowed to come. The consultant insists on presenting the case himself or herself. So I would feel personally that no harm is there if the associate is also taken along. Sometimes the associate may show his vulnerability or his genuineness more effectively than the consultant. So if you have a good case and if you think the associate is even reasonably articulate enough to put his case across, then it pays to take the associate. And the only other thing I have already told you, that if your documentations are good, then you don't need fancy methods, you don't need fancy databases. Your case can succeed without the help of various databases, and you don't need any jargon. Transfer pricing is, lot of jargons are there in transfer pricing. We say this benchmarking. Very often we don't know what this benchmarking exactly means. Then somebody will say PLI, I have taken this PLI. Then Berry ratio, for a long time I wondered what is Berry got to do with this ratio. But these terms are there in transfer pricing. So one has to live with all these terms, but I would suggest that if your core substance of the transaction is well documented in terms of document theories, then you don't need recourse to any of these technicalities. Your case can sail through even without power cut. So with that, I think I should have bored all of you enough. And just as the Big Four firm have really made a big name in international transfer pricing, it is my wish and hope. I see a lot of young people here. I see very some bright-faced young girls. So I would, it is my sincere hope that in domestic transfer pricing, domestic firms should also do very well. And just as Big Four firm has made a very good name and they have established a very good reputation in terms of international transfer pricing, in domestic transfer pricing, domestic firms should have similar name and similar capacity building, and they should guide the department just as the Big Four has guided us. So with that, I will wish all the best. I have seen the program scheduled for the day. It is very nicely scheduled, and I think many of the problems which I feel are a problem and I shared with you, probably all those things can be sorted out, or there could be some solution to all these issues which we will discuss in the course of the day. So with that, I inaugurate this session, and I hope you have a fruitful day. Thank you.
Thank you, madam, for a enlightening talk on this.
Thank you for this enlightening talk. It's a yoga session. Madam has rightly said that the Big Four firms have made their name in international transfer pricing, and so a wish expressed by madam that the domestic firms should come to their favor as far as this BTV is concerned. There was in fact a precise object behind this whole conference with which we started this idea of this conference. And we learn today many things. Of course, this may not be the end of the things, but this may be the beginning of our learning. So we should take it in that fashion. And if we make it that way, probably we will have a better case with us, and we will be able to represent rightly with the department as well as rightly expected from us. With that small remark, I have pleasant task of introducing the first technical speaker for today's session, Ms. Krishna Parthadekar. She is a fellow chartered accountant and also a certified public accountant from USA. She has the experience in the field of transfer pricing for almost 14 years. One can say right from the age where the transfer pricing provisions were introduced in India, right from that, she has been working in this field. Earlier, she was with PwC, and for around 5 years she was at PwC, and thereafter, since 2009, she has been with, 2004, I'm sorry. Since 2004, she is with Grant Thornton, and as of now, she is the head of the transfer pricing division of Grant Thornton India. She is focused on the group of transfer pricing, and she specializes in this field since 2000. She has advised a large number of renowned multinational and Indian companies in structuring the planning, intra-company transfers, etc. Some of her clients' name, just to name a few, are Glenmark, Larsen & Toubro, Renfro, Volta, Mercury Pharma, Nokia Group, etc. Apart from transfer pricing, her exposure is including the tax and regulatory of compliance of international tax, inbound and outbound investments, etc. Her specialization in the sector-wise specialization is pharmaceutical and information technology area. And she has been a member of the European Business Group and Chamber of Tax Consultants. She has presented not many papers all across India on the subject of transfer pricing and addressed various seminars. She is a regular writer on various papers on this subject. So very rich experience, which we are all looking forward to, and looking to a very good session. In today's session, we should be dealing with overview of the emergence of transferring eligibility provisions, and also scope of eligibility and interplay between specified domestic transfer pricing and the transfer pricing provisions. Also with reference to UN and OECD commentary. With this brief introduction, I present before you Ms. Karishma Bhattacharya, and before she takes the session, I will express our personal sincerity by please offer my answer to Ms. Karishma.
Thank you for acknowledging me as a young girl starting transfer pricing. I would still want to believe I'm young though. But we have, as she has been modest, I must say that we have also all learned transfer pricing through them. So it's an iterative process, because had they not done or had they not approached this whole subject in the way they have been in the past several years, we would have not been challenged to